Good evening, and welcome to Inside Creative Writing. My name is Robert Olin Butler, and I'm speaking to you from my office here on the campus of Florida State University in Tallahassee, Florida. And since October 30th, I've been here each night, except for Saturday nights, writing a short story. And I began this story on October 30th, and I think tonight is our 11th session. I began the story with simply an inspiration that itself was not simple at all. But all I brought to this office was a picture postcard. A postcard that spoke to me in a very deep and complex way. A postcard, and if you've been following me, you know this is a postcard from 1913, and I'll talk about how, if you haven't been following me, how to find that card and examine it more closely on this website in a moment. But that card inspired a short story, and all that that card had around it was the sense of inspiration and the sense that it was touching something truly deep in the place inside me where art comes from. And that's a place that I've been trying to identify for you through these broadcasts and distinguish from other kinds of places where people can write from, and quite effectively, but in modes of discourse that are separate from the essentials of art. And so the story has been progressing very well. We've had some setbacks, but on the whole, it's been going quite well, and I'm happy with it, at least at this point. Now, tonight will be another one of those evenings when I will begin, especially since, as these webcasts are being done, this is a Sunday evening, and I had a fruitful Friday evening, and then last night I took the night off, one night out of seven. I don't come in here and write. So tonight, since I've been away from the work for 48 hours, I'm going to take the opportunity with the colder eye that I bring to it tonight to go back when we begin our work, to go back and do a full read-through once again, working over the detail work, continuing to edit the work that's been on the page, and also then to absorb and reconnect with the longer rhythm of the piece. Now, those certain housekeeping matters that I mention each night for the sake of our new viewers, and I know that we're gathering viewers as we go. The Inside Creative Writing homepage that through which you entered this present moment of webcast, that homepage offers you the opportunity to do several things. First of all, when you return to that homepage, you'll see that on the lower half of the page there is a calendar. And in the dates of that calendar, you will find the opportunity to return to any of the previous 10 broadcasts, webcasts, and replay them in full. You just connect. You choose your connection speed on the given day, and you can see the webcast, the full 2 hours of it, at your leisure. Of course, manage to go to any parts within it. Also, on the calendar, you will find the opportunity to look at the short story as it stood at the end of each of those days. And then, up toward the top of the page, you will find two things. First of all, and very importantly, you'll find an opportunity to email me. There's an icon up there that you click on, and it'll take you into your email server, and I urge you, encourage and even urge you to write questions. Anything you'd like to comment on, anything you'd like to, for me to address, because I do spend the last half hour of our evening addressing questions. Anything you'd like me to talk about in general, about process, about art, about writing, or anything in specific about this story. You can ask me about any of the decisions that I have made so far. And some of you are offering some excellent comments about how you're responding to the story. And some of you are asking me about specific line editing, even very tiny things, which is fine. I'm open to all of that. And of course, you understand that at any given moment, when you're looking at my text, some of it is well worked over and some of it is still quite raw. So I may heartily agree with you in some of the, especially some of the line editing things that you may find, especially toward the end of the text. There will also be on that Inside Creative Writing homepage a way to see the postcard that I have based this short story on. And here it is. This is a card that I bought. Got my microphone wire caught up there. This is a postcard that I bought at a postcard collector's convention. And some of you may be wondering about my collection of postcards. I have dozens and dozens and dozens of these old picture postcards. And some of them are as equally as provocative as this one. And I'm going to be writing a book of short stories based on cards. But this particular one is of a very fragile biplane. And we have known from some internet research that we did on the first night that this is almost certainly taken in the month of June in 1913. And this very fragile looking biplane and you can click on this on the image of the card on that Inside Creative Writing homepage and see it in much more detail. And you will also see the back, and that's the important thing. On the back it says, "This is Earl Sant of Erie, Pennsylvania, in his aeroplane just before it fell." And that's written by whoever took this photograph. And it is the voice of that person. This man that is now, we're calling Paul, who is the narrator of our story, who is behind the creation of this short story. Okay, so let's get to work. Now, I still have some of our research laid out here from the other night, and I'm not certain yet if we still need these particular items. This is the research that I did on the Singer Building in New York City, which Paul visits, as you'll soon see, in the year of 1909. And at that point, it was the highest building in New York City. In fact, the tallest building in the world by some 250 feet. So let's go to the story. And the first thing I want to do is to come back to a place, oh, shortly before where I began on our last session. And my pattern of this is pretty typical now. We're falling into a pattern of looking primarily each day to go back up to a place somewhat before the place where I began the previous evening, and I work over and line edit and redream that section. And then on a slightly longer rhythm every several nights, and tonight is particularly apt for this because of, as I mentioned before, there's been now 48 hours since I last wrote on this story, skipping last night, and that's about as much time as I can stop without really causing some damage to the process. Fiction writers need to write every night. And that's a point I think I've made before. I know I have. And it's quite true, or write every day. And once you find your own rhythm, you may, as I have been doing, discover that you can stop for one night out of seven without it destroying the story. But if you stop two nights in a row, you do so at your great peril. If you stop three nights in a row, if you're at all like me, you're going to find on that fourth night when you go back that it feels as if you've never written a word before in your life. The demands of that unconscious that you must go into, your dream space, is so great on your levels of concentration that if you do not keep that link established and reestablished in a frequent rhythm, the link will disappear and vanish and erase all trace of itself. One other thing. In terms of reading things over, as you know, I read aloud a lot, and it's important to me because a narrative voice is terribly important, not only when writing in the first person, but even when writing in the third person. And as you know, I have been... The purpose of this webcast is to engage you in my process as it would happen in my real life. And in that regard, there's been one element, quite honestly, that's been missing. It's been here in a different form, and that's this reading aloud thing. And the reading aloud to myself is something that I would absolutely do. But also, I am married to a remarkable artist herself, a woman named Elizabeth Dewberry. And she also has a novel coming out early in the 2002, as do I, a book called Sacrament of Lies. And she's had two other novels published. And Betsy and I read to each other frequently. I like to read to her virtually every night. Her ear, just for her to hear me read it. Oftentimes she does not need to say anything because reading to her and understanding her sense, her aesthetics and her sensibility helps me to hear the story for myself in a way that I may not quite hear it in solitude. And for all of you, this is an awfully good thing to do. And I know many of you may be in writers' communities and writing workshops and even informal writers' groups where you listen to each other's work. And that can be very good. It can also can be very dangerous. And I would, if you're interested in my expounding on that further, I would recommend that you email me that question and remind me, because I don't want to get off on it now. But ask me about writers' groups, writers' circles, and so forth. But the ultimate point is you do need a good ear, an outside ear, to hear you, to hear your work. And that's why editors exist too, of course. But even before you get to the editor, it's wonderfully helpful to have someone whose sensibility you trust and who is able to get inside your work, and that's crucial. You do not want someone who has their own sense of the world so strongly when they listen to you that they simply try to impose the way they see things or their voice or their sensibility on your story. It has to be someone who is either already attuned to your sensibility in some deep way, and Betsy is to mine, certainly, and I to her. But at least the reader must be able to climb out of their own perspectives and take your story on its own terms to understand your voice and your vision in the way that you are trying to work it out from your own dream space. And and not impose some external or other kind of sensibility on it. Well, I can talk about all that stuff further if you wish, but right now, suffice to say that that the thing that's been left out of your impression of my process is that many of these evenings, if not most, if not all, I would have gone later in the day, and since I normally write in the morning, I would have that evening then, and letting it cool off for myself as well, getting some distance from it so I can hear it afresh, I would have read aloud what I'd written that day to Betsy. And I'm going to tell you now that I have not been doing that because I've kept the whole process here in this office. But probably, since I'm writing at night, probably tomorrow morning or tomorrow afternoon, before I come in again on our next session, I am going to read the story to Betsy in just the way I'm reading it here. In other words, looking myself as I read for those little bits of discrepancy or nuance that are not yet quite organically whole in the work. And she will give me a few of her reactions, just as I've been encouraging you to do through your emails. So I will bring, by when I get in tomorrow, I will have a printed text of the story with me where I will share some of her responses and see if I agree with them. Sometimes I do and sometimes I don't. Most of the time I do when it's Betsy. We'll again take a quick pass and fix up those things tomorrow. All right, but tonight let's start off by going back a ways, back before we began our last session. And and see what we have. Where do I want to go? Here we go. Let's start here. I stepped closer still. I grew bold. The air moved on my face, an air only the clouds knew. But I was part of a race of creatures of the earth who were remaking themselves into something new. I took the last step a man could take and not fall. I pressed against the sill and I bent forward at the waist and looked across the rooftops below, rooftops that themselves were higher than any tree on earth, but far below me now. And I looked beyond the docks and masts and smokestacks. I followed the bright thread of the Hudson River to Ellis Island and the statue of Madame Liberty, her arm lifted high. Earl Sant, I lift my arm to you, a blazing torch in my hand. Come here to me, guide your plane this way. Glide down to this flame and land safely beside me. Okay, here's an unintentional rhyme we're looking at, guide and glide, and they're even similar in other ways. Come here to me, guide your plane this way, glide down to this flame. And I'm not sure if I've noticed this in a way that means there's a problem or not. It doesn't fall in an iambic sort of way, in a way that where you begin to expect a rhyme, but maybe we can find a better word. Come here to me, guide your plane this way. Of course, Earl is not in a glider. Gliders were other kinds of planes anyway, so glide might be the wrong word. Paul is certainly aware of the technology such that he would not confuse those things. Come here to me, guide your plane this way. Fly down, fly down. I meant that. Okay, fly down. Earl Sant, I lift my arm to you, a blazing torch in my hand. Come here to me, guide your plane this way. Fly down to this flame and land safely beside me. Using fly, I'm not sure down should be there. Earl Sant, I lift my arm to you, a blazing torch in my hand. Come here to me, guide your plane this way, fly to this flame and land safely beside me. Does that put too much emphasis on the alliteration? Fly to this flame. Fly down to this flame. Earl Sant, I lift my arm to you, a blazing torch in my hand. Come here to me, guide your plane this way. Fly down to this flame and land safely beside me. That's better. Prose can be quite beautiful. Fiction writers need not and should not, if it's part of the natural organic voice of the piece, they should not avoid the occurrence of things that one might respond to with a sense of beauty about the language. And indeed, the beauty of language then often resides in verbal effects that one associates with poetry. Rhyme, alliteration, for example. But the ultimate test is whether the beauty of the language or the poetic effect is organic, whether it is justified in terms of that total organic resonation of everything within the piece. Every tiny detail needs to, at its deepest sensual pattern, reinforce, reflect, add to, certainly not conflict with, the everything else. It's hard to, I cannot think of an example where rhyme, for example, is going to be organic in a work of fiction. It might, I can't say never, but it's hard to imagine. The accidental rhyme is something that almost always turns out to be not organic and not functional. Alliteration sometimes can be very effective in good prose fiction style. But when it asserts itself too much and just becomes a kind of, and we become aware of the sound as opposed to letting the quality of the sound enforce the emotional content of that moment, then it's wrong. It does not work. That's true of any stylistic effect. And in this case, when I took the word down out, fly down at first seemed too strange, a little bit of a phrase. Glide down works, fly down not quite so much. But then I ended up with fly to this flame, which then the sounds were very strong and did not really add to the moment, seems to me. And why is a question that is only referenceable to one's sense of music and the appropriate emotional valence of a given musical effect. So I put the down back in and feels okay to me. Earl Sant, I lift my arm to you, a blazing torch in my hand. Come here to me, guide your plane this way. Fly down to this flame and land safely beside me. I look from where I sit in the rattan chair, my hands on the steering handle. I see the flame below, and my wing has not yet torn. I nudge my aeroplane gently downward, down toward the man and the boy. I will be safe. But I am not Earl Sant. He is dead. I have seen men die before. And you know, we circle back in this sentence, you understand, from the first sentence in the story. I have seen men die before. My father, long ago, his lungs bricked up solid with pneumonia. A man in the Alleghenies, broken beneath a felled tree when I was young and working in timber. And that resonates back to the tree he himself felled in his yard, doesn't it? Again, connecting the trees and death there, the cutting down of a tree to death, and by implication, the tree itself taking on a valence of life. And another in New York City, on that day in 1909, when I went out of the Singer Building and into the streets that were dim even near noon, streets narrow and full of rushing men and the hammering of metal and the whine of wheels and the mutter of automobile engines and the clatter of a distant elevated train. And I turned to look up at the place where I'd stood, in the middle of the air, and my eyes went up and up, impossibly high, up the great red brick and bluestone column, up to its great mansard roof. Now, red brick, hyphenated, turns the adjective noun combination into an adjectival unit. In doing that, one expects a noun to follow, and when it doesn't, you pause perhaps very briefly, balking a little bit at that hyphen. And so what I'm going to do here is to reverse the bluestone and red brick. So when we hit the hyphenated word, the noun that it's modifying immediately follows. And I think that fixes my little moment of concern. And I'm going to back up to the beginning of that sentence, which is way up in the air here. And another in New York City on that day in 1909, when I went out of the Singer Building and into the streets that were dim even near noon, streets narrow and full of rushing men and the hammering of metal and the whine of wheels and the mutter of automobile engines and the clatter of a distant elevated train. And I turned to look up at the place where I'd stood, in the middle of the air, and my eyes went up and up, impossibly high, up the great bluestone and red brick column. Bluestone, by the way, as one word, is the correct spelling of that. It's not a bluestone is a kind of stone, and that's why it's one word instead of hyphenated. Impossibly high, up the great bluestone and red brick column, up to its great mansard roof and cupola and the bright sky beyond. Step lively, a voice said, and I looked, and I could not pick the speaker out of 100 bowlered men moving all about me. I stepped away up the street, which was cloaked in shadow as far as I could see. I moved, and suddenly before me there was a gathering of men, and some bowlers were coming off, and I came up. He was in a greatcoat, in spite of the heat. He was sprawled face down, his arms outstretched, his legs spread wide. The men about him were quiet. I thought to look up. A gray stone building loomed over us, perhaps 200 feet high. I looked back down to the dead man. A policeman pushed past me and bent to the body. I found myself standing beside my desk in the bank on the morning after Earl Sant died. I could not recall the act of rising from this chair. Okay. That feels okay to me. That feels good. Do you understand what's happening? I just noticed. Do you understand what he's doing here? In a gray stone building loomed over his prep. The men were about him, were quiet. I thought to look up. He sees the building. I look back down to the dead man. Policeman pushed past me. What is in his mind? Or in his sensibility? Because he does not say what it is, and he does not say what it is because it is coming on him unbidden, I think. I think he looks up the building because he looks at the way in which this man is lying on the street. It suggests to him, to Paul, that the man has jumped from the building, has committed suicide. So he looks up, he looks at the dead man. The reason he looks up the building is because something in him is connecting that way he's lying, and he came from up there. But notice, he does not meditate on suicide. He does not think about suicide. He doesn't say suicide. Nothing about that. All right, let's go back to the beginning. And we're going to work through this again and see what we find. And I'm reading this aloud, and oftentimes I will also, I mean, you know, at a point, some points I read in silence. But I'll read tonight aloud, which I often do anyway. And reading aloud, this reading aloud is different from the kind of reading I would, for instance, give once this is a finished story, and if I'm in a bookstore or in a university and giving a reading, and I love to do that, and I enjoy doing that. The reading is different. I'm reading now in a different way, because different and the same in both cases. I'm through the voice and through my concentration, I'm going inside Paul and hearing his voice as I'm speaking it, as if from inside him. That's important to understand about this process, because it's certainly true while I'm writing as well. I am inside Paul. I've talked about method acting, I think, at some point in one of these broad webcasts, and I think I even pointed out that I'm a kind of method writing teacher. And this is part of that. For me, the process involves making your own inner life come into concert with the inner life of the character through whom you're writing, or the narrator. It works in third person too. Your inner life is part of that narrative persona, because even a third person narrator, even the most objective third person narrator, has a discernible personality. And so you go inside that personality, and in the third person narrator, it's interesting, there's a kind of mediation of that third person narrator even for you. You become part of the third person narrator, and then your third person narrator becomes at times a method actor and not just a camera eye. The third person narrator gets into and becomes part of the point of view character or characters that the third person narrator has access to. So it's two levels of method acting entering into. But in this case, there's just the one unmediated level. And so as I read now, I certainly will be entering into Earl Sant's sensibility, but not in the way that I would in performing from the story in a reading in a university or a bookstore setting, for example. Then I would certainly enter into it, and knowing that the text held Paul fully and appropriately. So the reading through of the editing process, the redreaming process, the revision process, involves a kind of duality in the writer. I'm reading through, entering into Earl Sant as Earl Sant. But part of me is also responding to, I say Earl Sant, I mean Paul. I enter in as Paul, but part of me is responding to the essence of Paul as well, in a way that senses him and is prepared, and indeed is from a position not outside of Paul, but even perhaps deeper in than this voice. This voice represents my having been inside Paul so far. And when I re-enter the text, I'm re-entering Paul as he exists here. But I also simultaneously have to enter Paul in a deeper way, a way in which the discrepancies of this Paul, the text Paul, varies from the deeply perceived Paul in my unconscious. This is a complex point. I hope you understand what I just talked about. I've never said these things before, and that's one great thing about this webcast, is I'm learning things about my own process even as I speak them to you. And about the method acting aspect of it, where the author, the artist, enters in to the character and the voice through the voice in a sort of method acting way, where I'm bringing my inner life into concert with this character that I am in the midst of creating. And in that correspondence of inner lives, the words come and I put them on the screen. But that does not mean that they are perfect, because they're being brought through the filter of language, which is a very difficult medium. And so then this rereading process engages the method acting notion in two ways. You enter the text Paul as a method actor, making your inner life come into correspondence with the Paul as he exists in the text. But on some deeper level, you have entered Paul in a much deeper, as yet unspoken way, that even deeper Paul, so that you can, as you re-experience the textual Paul from the inside, you can discern the discrepancies between the textual Paul and that even deeper true Paul, which is very interesting. I honestly had not ever thought, much less spoken, that insight before, and I thank you for it. All right, let's do this. I've seen a man die, but not like this. There was silence suddenly around us when he had disappeared beyond the trees. Silence after terrible sounds. That hammering of his engine, the engine of his aeroplane, and the other sound after. He climbed miraculously up, and he had circled the field, and all our hats came off as one, us men. Mine as well. Hooray, we cried. My son cried out too, hooray. We waved our hats in the air as if we'd just seen Honus Wagner double down the left field line. This was why we'd come to this meadow. We would peek into the future and cheer it on. And Earl Sant hammered overhead and down to the far edge of the pasture, defying the trees, defying the earth. The propeller of his engine spun behind him, and he sat in a rattan chair as if he was on his front porch smoking a cigar. Then he came back from the tree line, heading our way. I reached down and touched my son on the shoulder. I had never seen an aeroplane, and something was changing in me as it approached. I suppose it scared me some. I had no premonition, but I needed to touch my son at that moment, and the plane came toward us, and there was a stiff wind blowing. The plane bucked a little like a nervous horse, but Earl Sant kept him steady, kept him coming forward, and I felt us all ready to cheer again. Then there was a movement on the wing, with no particular sound, still the engine, but there was a tearing away. If I had been Earl Sant, if I had been sitting in that rattan chair and flying above these bared heads, I might have heard the sound and been afraid. I lifted my camera. This had nothing to do with the thing happening on the wing. I was only vaguely aware of it in that moment. I lifted my camera, and I tripped the shutter, and here was another amazing thing, it seemed to me. One man was flying above the earth, and with a tiny movement of a hand, another man had captured him. Earl Sant was about to die, but he was forever caught there in the box in my hand. I lowered my Kodak Eduardo asked about this the other night, and I explained it correctly. that Earl Sant was about to die now. One man was flying above the earth, and with a tiny movement of the hand, another man had captured. That is in his mind at the time. I lifted my camera, I tripped the shutter, and here's another amazing thing, it seemed to me, at the time. Earl Sant was about to die comes later. Now, I wanted, and what I said was correct about that, but I wonder if perhaps the paragraph would help a reader, and Eduardo is certainly a sensitive reader, help him and other readers to understand that there has been a shift now from the moment when he was thinking at the time he used the camera and later. And making it the topic sense, as it were, of that paragraph also puts a, you know, punches it a little bit. I lifted my camera and I tripped the shutter, and here was another amazing thing, it seemed to me. One man was flying above the earth, and with a tiny movement of a hand, another man had captured him. Earl Sant was about to die, but he was forever caught there in that box in my hand. I lowered my Kodak, and for a moment the plane was before me against the sky, and all I felt was a thing that I sometimes had felt as a younger man, riding up into the Alleghenies alone, and there would be a turning in the path, and suddenly the trees broke apart, and there was a great falling away of the land. A falling. He fell, Earl Sant. The aeroplane pitched forward, and for a moment it seemed to stop and to hang against the sky, and the engine hammered on, and then it fell, disappearing behind a stand of pine. There was a heavy thump behind the trees, beyond the trees, and I have nothing in my head to compare it to, not a barn collapsing, not a horse going down, not the dead sugar maple 40 foot high I had felled only yesterday in our yard. This sound was new, and our silence followed. We all of us could not take this in. He had flown, this Earl Sant. He had raised his goggles to his eyes and stepped into the machine, his machine, and he had run along the meadow. You know, since I'm doing this read through, I'm going to take a couple of your questions now and deal with them. On line editing matters. Greg Fitz asks about a couple of points. He says, "We all of us seems to cover the crowd a couple more times than is needed." Actually, only one extra, because all of us, of course, is the all is not fully complete until the us is there. All of what? But we all of us could not take this in. The emphasis, and it's and really, and understand, of course, Greg, that this is a spoken thing, too, a vernacular thing, and we do repeat ourselves in spoken speech. And the reason we repeat it is that is for the emotional emphasis of things. Our silence followed. We all of us could not take this in. That taps in its repetition, the we all of us. It's colloquial, but it also taps in its repetition the sense of the unity of the crowd. The crowd, he, you know, the way in which they all share this terrible experience. And he goes on to say that, right, and I think that's all we needed on that one. Greg has another point a little later, but I wanted to deal with that one. And the repetition, by the way, of the subjects here. He had flown this Earl Sant. He had raised his goggles. We got really three subjects of that next sentence also. But it's the repetition of emotion. This thing happened, this thing happened. It's almost like, in each case here, it's the same thing that keeps us replaying the vision of 9/11, that vision of that plane going in and going in. We all of us, he had flown this Earl Sant, he had raised his goggles. It's the emotional moment that's being reflected in the repetition. And our silence followed. We all of us could not take this in. He had flown this Earl Sant, he had raised his goggles to his eyes and stepped into his machine.
and he had run along the meadow and had lifted into the air, and now I looked into the empty place where he had been only a moment before. In my head I could see once again the two great wings and the spinning of the propeller, and then he was gone. "Papa," it was my son's voice drifting up to me from the silence. I looked into his face. "It's all right," I said, though I knew it was not. I could feel Matthew's bones beneath my hand, which still lay on his shoulder. "He's gone," my son said. I looked to the others. There was a stirring. "Mother of God," one man said, and he began to move in the direction of the pines. He was right. We had to do something now. You understand, Earl, I keep confusing Earl and Paul here. Paul interprets the Mother of God comment. And the movement, of course. So I let go of my son and turned to the place where Earl Sant had vanished. "Stay here," I said. We ran, perhaps a dozen of us, across the meadow grass and into the pines, and I could smell burning, and there was smoke up ahead, and I could smell a newly familiar thing, a smell of the automobiles that had come to our town, their fuel. Then we broke into a clearing, and the aeroplane was crumpled up ahead and beginning to burn. I was behind several of the men, and we were in our Sunday clothes. We had left our churches this morning and had come to see the exhibition of this wonderful thing, and now we were stripping off our coats and winding them around our hands and arms to allow us to reach into the flames to bring Earl Sant out. Two men were ahead of me, already bending to the tangle of canvas and wood and metal and smoke. I felt myself slow and stop. Speaking of slowing and stopping, and also sniffing. A couple of nights ago, I was struggling with a little something, and you know, I think as a matter of fact, and last night and this morning, it got much worse. I'm doing better at the moment, but even tonight, I don't feel very well. I'm working on a head cold, and I think keeping it at bay, forgive the little bit of snuffling that I do tonight. I mention this because I want to emphasize to you, and I think I've done this before when I was not feeling good one night, and I'm trying to share everything of this process with you. And one's physical condition in these matters, and I've talked to you about how I've been sleeping lately and so forth, and because I, all of this comes to bear on your process. It really does. And the fact is, I have to be extremely sick in order not to write. I have to be very sick. I mean, very sick. Not to come to my writing space and write when I am in the midst of a piece of work. I spoke earlier this evening about the need to write every day. It is a seriously important thing for a fiction writing artist to maintain that connection to the unconscious and to keep working. And so, as the athletes have to play hurt, I think writers need to write sick sometimes. You know, obviously, you have to take care of yourself. I'm not suggesting you don't. But I'm also saying that you need to be very sick. That it begins that the sickness is interfering with the connection to your unconscious. If the sickness does not interfere with the connection to your unconscious, and the physical act of writing is not going to endanger your health, then you need to write. So that's why I bring up this, and as also an apology for snuffling some. Okay. I did not know this man. I had seen him only from afar, only briefly. He had raised his goggles and hidden his eyes, and he'd had some intent in his head to fly, of course, and he did. But he was a man, flesh and blood, and he was lying broken now ahead of me. There were others to help him, the ones ahead, and still others now, rushing past me. I continued to hesitate, and then I turned away. Matthew had followed me. He was standing a few yards behind in the trees. I lifted my hand to acknowledge him, and I found it swathed in my suit coat, expecting the fire. You remember earlier, And this is interesting, this we all of us thing. He has a reaction to this crash with an initial, and it persists for a while, an initial pretty strong sense of being part of this group who's witnessed this. Even to the point that, if you notice, when he's running through the trees, he said, now we were stripping off our coats and winding them around our hands and arms to allow us to reach into the flames to bring Earl Sand out. The act of stripping off his coat and winding it around his hand and arm, which he obviously has done, his perception of it was as part of the group doing that. So much so that at the moment that he lifts his arm to Matthew, it surprises him now. Suddenly, having seen Matthew, Paul disengages himself from this group experience. And this is, I think this is something true, isn't it, about the witnessing of a terrible tragedy. 9/11, which has been a point of reference for us sometimes in this story. That when we see the tragedy, we saw that tragedy, we would move back and forth into a sense of being of a group experience and being not really an individual in some ways, but a part of a real witnessing group. And then at other times we face a much more individual response. And Paul feels that group response until what? He sees his son. He sees his son. Matthew had followed me. He was standing a few yards behind in the trees. I lifted my hand to acknowledge him, and I found it swathed in my suit coat, expecting the fire. I moved to my son, unwrapping my arm. The others are helping, I said to him, so he'd understand why I had turned away. I want to see, he said. No, Pa, no, I said, firm. I turned him around, and we stepped out of the trees into the meadow. I looked once more into the sky, where Old Sant had been. Matthew and I walked from the meadow and through the center of town, passing the Merchants Bank, where I had an office, where I was vice president. And we moved beneath the maples of our street, old trees, dense above us now. And we were quiet, my son and I. The meadow, the open sky, all of that was left behind. Then we reached a place along the road where I could see my house ahead. The maple was gone from the front edge of my property, dead from blight and felled by my own hand. I looked away, not wanting to, but I felt suddenly bereft of this tree. I was sorry for its passing, this tree. Matthew broke away from me now, began to run. I looked. His mother was coming down the porch steps. My son ran hard to her, not calling out. She turned her face toward us, saw him approaching, sensing, I think, that something had happened. I stopped, still separate from them. My daughter, a tall, gangly girl, my sweet Naomi, emerged from the house, and for a moment they all three were before us, before me. In the house itself, let me see if that's readable. My daughter, a tall, gangly girl, my sweet Naomi, emerged from the house, and for a moment they all three were before me. In the house itself, a fine house, a house we'd lived in for 4 years now, a solid house with its hipped roof and double-windowed dormer and its clapboard siding, the color of the sunlight in the brightness of noon. My wife went down on one knee, and Matthew reached her and he threw his arms around her neck. I knew I should move forward to explain, but what would I say? Naomi came to the two of them, put her hand on her crouching mother's shoulder. There was a seizing in my chest. I wanted to take them all three up into my arms, but instead I stood dumbly there, watching. Finally, Rachel's face lifted to look at me over Matthew's shoulder. I felt heavy now, rooted to this earth, as if I'd decided to take the place of the dead maple. But I made myself move. I took a step and another, and there was a loosening inside me as I moved toward my family. My wife tilted her head slightly, a questioning gesture, I think. Naomi looked at me too, came around her mother, and I was glad she was drawing near, and she put her arms around me. I felt the bones in her arms pressing at my back. I held her tight. What was it, Daddy? An accident, I said. It was just an accident. Maddie said he was dead, the man. We don't know that for sure. He fell? Yes. She said no more, but she needed me to hold her closer, and I did. "It's all right," I said. "We're all right." Matthew could not sleep. The house was dark, and my wife and I had just extinguished the lamp alone and undistracted at last. Then we heard his cry, wordless, and Rachel rose. I knew what it was about. As she disappeared, I looked toward the dark gape of the bedroom doorway, and I gripped the sheet as if to put it aside and to rise. But I hesitated. I should not have hesitated to go to my son, but I did. For one moment, and then another. I forced myself to throw back the sheet and put my feet on the floor. I stood. I made my way across the room and down the hall, and my son's tears were fading as I approached. I stood in his doorway, and his mother said to him, "It's okay, Maddie. God decided he wanted an aeroplane pilot in heaven." "Like he wanted Henry for an angel," my son said. I turned away. I moved back down the hall and then stopped, neither here nor there. Matthew's first cousin Henry, my brother's son, had died of smallpox. My son had already encountered death. Of course he had. We had all encountered death. It was a part of our daily lives. Always, we waited for the first sneeze, the first cough, the first spot on our skin. We waited to be carried away, if not from smallpox, then from influenza, or from scarlet fever, or from diphtheria, or from pneumonia, or from tuberculosis. It was the way of the world. I believed in God, that he managed our lives, that he would call us when he chose to, and I was glad my son could picture his blood kin, a child of his own age, as an angel and not as a corpse in the ground. But I stood in the middle of the hallway, and I dragged my forearm across my brow, and I was having trouble drawing a breath. I waited in bed, sitting propped up in the dark, sweating still. Finally, Rachel appeared in the door, quietly, pausing there in the dim light, her white nightgown glowing faintly as if she were a ghost. I spoke to her at once to drive the image from my mind. "Is he all right?" "I don't know," she said, and she floated this way. "Rachel," I said. "Yes." She was beside my bed, the bed now. I had spoken her name without anything more to say. I just needed to say her name. "Nothing," I said. "What happened out there?" "The plane crashed," I said. "These machines aren't safe." Rachel drew back the sheet and sat beside me. "Paul," I looked toward her. Her face was there, turned to me, featureless in the dark. She touched my hand and spoke almost in a whisper. "What happened?" "I don't know." I was Earl Sant. Sitting in my rattan chair, I looked down and the faces all turned upward and the mouths all opened to cry out, but the only sound I could hear was the rush of air about me as I flew. I flew and the lift was not in my wings, it was in my chest, my very chest, and I was buoyed up and moving quickly, and there was nothing around me now, not the aeroplane, not the rattan chair, only the wide, bright air. I looked down again, and there was only one face below, and it was my own. Mine. I woke. I sat up quickly, expecting to rise from the bed and up through the ceiling and out into the night sky, but I was awake. I was sitting on my bed. Nevertheless, I lifted my eyes and I saw the aeroplane, its broad wings, the fragile bones holding them in place, the bones stretching behind to the smaller back wings, the tail. I don't know if I've commented on this the last time through, but do you notice that he identifies the wood structure of the plane as being bones? And if you look at the postcard, you can see that certainly they're like more like bones than, you know, great structural pieces. And of course that connects the plane. He's touched Matthew's shoulder and felt the bones there. He felt his daughter's bones in her arms. And of course these are reflections of his deep and sudden and inescapable confrontation with mortality. And now his perceptions of his children are further connected to, you know, and as with any father worrying, when you confront mortality, you do so at, certainly in whatever other ways, you also do it in terms of your children And this further emphasizes, connects the children, his sense of the children's mortality with the plane because of the bones. The bones connect those things. Okay, I lifted my eyes and I saw the aeroplane, its broad wings, the fragile bones holding them in place, the bones stretching behind to the smaller back wings, the tail. And then one of the wings let go at the very tip, let go and pointed to the earth. And the aeroplane followed. The front wheel at Earl's feet simply curved down as if finding an invisible slope in the sky. It followed this mountainside quickly downward and it was gone. I'm looking at the postcard now. My sense of has always been when I've looked at that card that tip of the wing has flopped downward. And I wonder if that is so. Given the way wings lift, I think I need, and I won't do that right now, I need to just consider the aerodynamics of this a bit. And I'm going to make a note to myself to do that. Yeah. And if any of you know anything about aeroplane aerodynamics, tell me, you look at that postcard and tell me if you think that tip of that upper wing, that upper right wing, is lifting up or going down as it tears. Is that coming down or is it going up, the tip part? And if so, what effect is that going to have on the aerodynamics? Is the nose of that plane going to go down from there? Is that the way it would crash? Or would it flip up and down? That's a bit of aerodynamics I need to work out, and I'm going to have to do that. And if any of you have any expertise, and please, you know, tell me if you're guessing, because I need something authoritative on this. Let's resume tomorrow with that, and I hope you can, if any of you can help me answer that question, I would appreciate it, and give me your sources if you have them, or from your own authority. But I'm putting this note to myself over here so I won't forget it. I just want to re-examine the aerodynamics there a little bit, just, you know, for the sake of rightness. Okay, the front wheel at Earl's feet simply curved down as if finding an invisible slope in the sky. It followed this mountainside quickly downward and it was gone. And then the sound. I jumped up from the bed, knocking into the bedstand. "What is it?" Rachel cried. "It's all right." "I'm all right," I said. "What is it, Maddie?" "It was a dream," I said. I do not require silence at the breakfast table. We eat together each day, my wife and my son and my daughter and I, even when my children have one leg skewed out from under the table, ready to run into the summer morning. They have their duties in this house, but the mornings are theirs. It is best to let a child feel his freedom in the morning, and they are free to speak as well. I like to listen to the movement of my children's minds. But this morning there was silence, a long period of silence, and their legs were under the table in spite of it being early summer. And without urging, Matthew was eating his egg, studiously sopping up the last bits of yolk with a piece of bread. I had not picked up this newspaper that lay folded beside my plate. I could see in large bold type in the upturned quarter the words "aviator killed." It was not uncommon for me to read the newspaper at the breakfast table, but only after we'd all had a chance to speak of the day to come. I looked at Rachel. She was lifting her coffee cup to her lips, and I could see that her eyes were on Matthew. He was intent on the bread, running it around and around the plate. Naomi was looking out the kitchen door. I followed her gaze. The sun was bright. The trees quaked. A scrap of paper blew across the yard, lifting briefly into the air, and then it fell and tumbled along. I placed my hand on the newspaper, but I did not open it. I looked at my hand. It covered the words in the headline. Finally, I said, "It looks like a fine day." Matthew lifted his face at this. "May I be excused?" he said. "Yes." He pushed back his chair and he rose, and only now was I hearing the flatness of his voice. He was a boy. This was the moment of the day to be relished above all others. "Maddie," my wife said, "are you all right?" He sees it, and she's obviously acknowledged that too, because she hears in the flatness of voice something's wrong. My son had moved toward the door. He stopped now and turned to us. His two shoulders lifted slightly and fell. It was a very small gesture, really, this shrug, but it made my eyes close so as not to see it. This gesture in my son, that was not the gesture of a child at all. Too late. I opened my eyes. He was pushing through the screen door, not having spoken a word. A Monday morning in the year of our Lord, 1913, a desk in a bank, a newspaper tucked under my arm and then put away in a drawer. I sat and my hands were flat and unmoving. On the top of my desk, my mahogany desk, and above me was a high window, and I have always liked the calm of sky looking over me, and I have liked the hush of the bank. All right, let's go back to the beginning of this. Greg Fitz also asked me to look at this opening bit, and I see what he's referring to. Now, Paul has often fragmented himself, fragmented his sentences and so forth. And the question is there an emotional rightness to these fragments? A Monday morning in the year of our Lord, 1913, a desk in a bank, a newspaper tucked under my arm and then put away in a drawer. Is it in concert, in essence, with the emotional moment? And it feels right to me, Greg, and I tell you why. We've had precedents of his doing this in the past, before, verbless fragments. He has gotten to his desk, and his intent now is to return to the thing that's settled. And verbs are the words of forward movement of time, of action. And right now, the movement of time is scary to him. It's the fall of the plane. He has been trying through the story here since seeing this to make things settle down, to keep them stable, settled, fixed. If you declare the things that are solid and that he can hold on to put them out there without letting the process of time get at them, that is with verbs, I think that fits quite well Paul's emotional state. A Monday morning in the year of our Lord, 1913, a desk in a bank, a newspaper tucked under my arm and then put away in a drawer. And we transition back to the emotion because he had to put that newspaper away. I sat and my hands were flat and unmoving on the top of my desk, my mahogany desk, and above me was a high window, and I have always liked the column of sky looking over me, and I have liked the hush of the bank. It is not blasphemy to say that the hush was like that of a church. We protected the money of the people of this town, and their money was a measure of their hard work, and their hard work rightly gave them the things of this world, the things of a world changing rapidly now. The hush of the bank, and there were low voices murmuring, and I knew their words. I could hear terrible, and I could hear aeroplane, and I could hear fire, and I could hear dead. I wanted to stand up and cry out to my tellers and my customers, "Go about your business, all of you. Just go about your business." But I did not stand. I swiveled in my chair, and I raised my eyes to the window, to the empty morning sky. I had myself gone up into that sky, higher even than Earl sat. I had stood in the air. I had stood and looked out on a great city, on a world of business and banking, a world of making goods and buying and selling and building houses and factories, and I looked out on steamships and trains and bridges and far off a vast sea, and I was standing within a thing as great as all of that, the Singer Building. the highest building in the world at that moment in the summer of 1909, when my host, a fellow banker, lifted his office window on the 38th floor, and I trembled like a horse before a fire. I crept forward, and I felt my chest swell. I grew large with fear and happiness to look at this city, vast and multiform. He's taking his time looking at it, so I'll put the comment. I grew large with fear and happiness to look at this city, vast and multiform in its stone and marble and terracotta, the work of human hands. I stepped closer still. I grew bold. The air moved on my face, an air only the clouds knew. But I was part of a race of creatures of the earth who were remaking themselves into something new. I took the last step a man could take and not fall. I pressed against the sill, and I bent forward at the waist and looked across the rooftops below, rooftops that themselves were higher than any tree on earth, but far below me now. And I looked beyond the docks and masts and smokestacks. I followed the bright thread of the Hudson River to Ellis Island and the statue of Madame Liberty, her arm lifted high. Earl Sant, I lift my arm to you, a blazing torch in my hand. Come here to me. Guide your plane this way. Fly down to this flame and land safely beside me. I look from where I sit in the rattan chair, my hands on the steering handle. I see the flame below, and my wing is not yet torn. I nudge my aeroplane gently downward, down toward the man and the boy. I will be safe. You notice the eye shifts abruptly here. And to whatever extent we lag just a moment behind, that's fine. This mixing of Earl Sant's and our narrator is a thing that's kind of evolving here. And so the technical device here is pretty bold, which is, Earl Sant, I lift my arm to you, a blazing torch in my hand. Come here to me, guide your plane this way, fly down to this flame and land safely beside me. The I in that sentence is Paul. I look from where I sit in the rattan chair, and that I is Earl. Now, you don't know what to start with. This is like a dissolve, by the way. I think I mentioned to you earlier about the connection between fiction technique and film technique, and that's something I'd be happy to expound on at greater length, too, at some point, if you send me a question. But one of the filmic techniques that we understand is a dissolve. A dissolve is where an image fades out and another image fades in, superimposed over it. And for a moment, we see both images kind of mixed up. We don't know what's which. And I think you can see here the filmic technique of the dissolve being used in the text here. Come here to me, guide your plane this way, fly down this flame and land safely beside me. The eye is Paul. I look from where I sit. And we don't know, at this, reading this sentence, reading I look from where I sit, we think it's Paul in the rattan chair, and suddenly the only rattan chair, and it's a very carefully planted one, that rattan chair is in the plane. And in Paul's dream, he was speaking in Earl Sand's voice already once, so we are also prepared for that. So as soon as we hit the rattan chair, our vision is suddenly, for a moment, the two things have laid over each other. Paul and Earl are one. I look from where I sit in there, they are one there. And we really sense that retrospectively once we hit rattan chair. And that's the dissolve. And obviously it has a organic use here in that it, one of the trends in this story, one of the things that's developing is this, is Paul's intense identification with Earl Sant. And I'm sure that's something that will resolve itself again, I mean, later in future writing, I suspect, in the story. But, you know, that's very carefully, clearly conveyed here in this technique. I nudge my airplane down, I will be safe. But I am not Earl Sant. He is dead. He keeps pulling back, as some of you have observed about him. I have seen men die before. My father, long ago, his lungs bricked up solid with pneumonia. a man in the Alleghenies broken beneath a felled tree when I was young and working in timber, and another in New York City on that day in 1909 when I went out of the Singer Building and into the streets that were dim even near noon, streets narrow and full of rushing men and the hammering of metal and the whine of wheels and the mutter of automobile engines and the clatter of a distant elevated train, and I turned to look up at the place where I'd stood in the middle of the air, and my eyes went up and up, impossibly high, up the great bluestone and red brick column, up to its great mansard roof and cupola, and the bright sky beyond. "Step lively," a voice said, and I looked, and I could not pick the speaker out of 100 bowlered men moving all about me. I stepped away up the street, which was cloaked in shadow as far as I could see. I moved, and suddenly before me there was a gathering of men, and some bowlers were coming off, and I came up. He was in a great coat in spite of the heat. He was sprawled face down, his arms outstretched, his legs spread wide. The men about him were quiet. I thought to look up. A gray stone building loomed over us, perhaps 200 feet high. I looked back down to the dead man. A policeman pushed past me and bent to the body. I found myself standing beside my desk in the bank on the morning after Earl Sant died. I could not recall the act of rising from this chair.
Good.
Not to put too much stress on it, but of course this building that looms over him with the dead man down is the typical gray, whereas the building that had represented the hope of the future and all the greatness of the city was blue and red. Which are colors on the American flag too, not come to think of it. Okay. All right, we need to get back into the story now. I'm not going to be able to do a lot of new words tonight, but you understand also it counts for your writing time. I'm going to try to get some more words down just to keep the link going, and I think it's an awfully important idea that sometimes when you are in your writing space, your writing every day also includes rewriting, revising, but only when the rewriting and rewriting and the revising is done in the proper way, which is as redreaming, and that you are inside, you are definitely connected to your unconscious when you are revising and rewriting. And even just line editing and touching up, it has to be from within your dream space. It is not an external analytical process where you don't go into your unconscious. You must be in your unconscious even for line editing, because every technical detail has a deeply resonant implication, is absolutely connected to everything else that's been coming from the dream space, and so that's where the revision of it must come from as well, which is what I've been doing. So, you know, that counts. That I am connected to my unconscious tonight in the revising. And so even if the session stopped right now, it would be all right that I didn't add any new words. But the extra thing is that I really want to add more words tonight. I need at least a few, just a few, just to keep, to add some more new words from the unconscious. And as a matter of fact, the fact that I'm not having time to do a few hundred, you know, I'm even on the verge of trying to decide whether or not to add more words tonight. That's really a function of this webcast, because the process of revising that I just did obviously would have taken a lot less time in the 2 hours I spend writing every day, if I had not been doing as much explaining and talking and teaching, as it were, with you as I've gone along. So you rarely will be in the kind of odd little dilemma that I'm in right now, which is, you know, I've done a lot of good revising tonight, even though it's not been a major, it's been good, and I've been inside it, and I've got the rhythm of the story back. You're not going to have to make this terrible choice, which I really need to stop talking in order to not exacerbate. So I'm going to put in a few more words tonight before we go to our questions. So let's turn on our Puccini in return. These are notes we made the other night. As you know, these are the notes that we made from that that nighttime drive in. Paul goes out at noon instead of going home. We did that's where we've done that. Goes to the site of the plane crash. Okay. I'm just reviewing those little dreamstorming notes that we've done in the past. Okay. Okay, I found myself standing beside my desk in the bank on the morning after Earl Sant died. I could not recall the act of rising from this chair. I reached out my hand, stiffened my fingertips on the corner of my desk, held myself up. I had to go out, I realized. I moved to the coat rack and took my hat and I put it on my head, and I stepped from my office, and my secretary looked up and I said to her, "I'll be back shortly." She lifted her eyebrows ever so slightly. This was unlike me, of course, but I did not pause to explain. There was no explanation. I stepped into the sunlight before the bank, and I went down to the street and turned toward the meadow where he had gone down. All right, we've got him on his way back to the meadow. One thing I was considering, my silence there for a while, where I was fiddling with my fingers. By the way, I'm trying to share everything in my process with you. At home, in my house, in my study, I occasionally will jump up from the chair and pace around a bit. I think that's part of it too. And maybe go get a glass of water or just pace around. Or if Sophie, my Bichon Frise dog, is in the room, she realizes I've jumped up, she'll roll on her back and offer her tummy to be stroked, and I may stop to do that and so forth. There are little kinds of physical mannerisms of that sort that you're not seeing because of the circumstance. And sharing everything in process, some of that kind of just the physical, and of course all the time I'm doing that, I'm very much in the trance. So those are, you know, that's the, and I've given the analogy in the past of the being in the zone for the athletes. That's the equivalent of stepping out of the batter's box and hitting the, you know, I guess they don't have cleats anymore, and you don't see batters knocking the dirt out of their cleats much anymore. They've sort of lost that as a mannerism, but they've all got their various mannerisms. Reggie Sanders was, you know, flips his bat like this and so forth. Not that I'm a Diamondbacks fan, I'm a St. Louis Cardinals fan, but that's just one that struck me in this recent World Series. Those are these ways of somehow channeling off the kind of energy you get, physical energy, by being in this creative trance. And you may have, I'm wondering if you'd noticed, but I'm often bouncing
my leg also, and that I do not even just to compensate for not being able to pace. I do that all the time anyway when I'm riding. That's part of the process. And since I was sharing everything here about it, that's another element. So I'm glad I've gotten this far in. Now we're again one of those places where we're cutting. You know, the cut will go to the next scene, and that's where we're going to pick up tomorrow. At this moment, I imagine I'm sensing. Two major scenes here, Earl. That cross identification is going on even as I speak. Paul in the meadow is going to go back to the place where Sant fell. And then there, I still sense that Matthew is going to be involved in the climax of this story. So that's where we stand. And let's save that. And turn to your questions. Okay. I'm going to revisit here in response to an observation and question. Going to revisit something that I've revisited a number of times already, but I think obviously it still needs some clarification, and it's so crucial that I'm sure you'll understand why I need to do this. Hugh Herrer of Atlanta, Georgia, sends a lovely long email here, and I'm going to boil it down to a couple of paragraphs from the email. Get to the question most directly. He says, why can it not be that, and this has to do with this dream space question and where art comes from and where something other than art comes from as distinguished from that. He says, why can it not be that in day-to-day yearnings and thoughts and other creative musings of an artist, a character, a yearning, and even a resolution or change in the character, the ending, come piece by piece together in the subconscious of said writer-artist, only to come to full fruition in a sort of writer's epiphany. The slow and perhaps even unnoticed development of the character and his experiences still came about in the artist's zone or creative faculties, only in different way and time. For that matter, why could it not happen backwards, that the character's epiphany is realized first, and then the process works backward to create the situation that inspired it? To sum up, how can the method and sequence of creation be used to define an artist versus novelist? Now, let me stop first of all here, because this is a distinction that Hugh's making that I did not make. I'm distinguishing not between artists and novelists, because obviously many novelists are artists, and there are great works of art that are in the form of novels. But the distinction is between artists and something that Hugh applied the word novelist to, because it's true, in absence, I did not identify them, the other kind of writing, in a single kind of labeled way. It's the artist versus, let's say, the non-artist or the entertainment writer, but that doesn't quite get at it either. There's other kinds of writing that have purposes besides even fiction writing, whose purpose is not entertainment, strictly, but may also not have the artistic impulse or drive or ultimately be an object of art. When I spoke about this kind of thing first, I included Jean-Paul Sartre, for example, as novelist, as well as a Stephen King, for example. So, Hugh, first of all, I'm not distinguishing between artist and novelist, but You raise a good question, and it says, does it not all come from a synthesis of the writer's collective being experiences, no matter the process of realization? Perhaps more importantly, what do you think is the difference in the results of these two methods that warrants the differentiation? Well, If you're hearing Hugh for the method that I taught of pre-dreaming a novel, you'll know that I'm in complete agreement with you in the premise that the artist can well, before writing moment to moment and going into the unconscious, could very well anticipate from the dream space, from the unconscious, from the legitimate, non-willed, rational parts, can in fact anticipate all kinds of things well into the book or the story, even perhaps an epiphany, an ending, could well. And I am not against that. Indeed, I have taught here one of the nights a method for actually going in and finding those things ahead of time in a dream state way. And so, absolutely, what I'm saying here is not that the artist cannot let herself know anything ahead of time and must start at the beginning and move through. What I am saying is that whatever things you think you know from your unconscious, and maybe they are from the unconscious, but whatever things you think are going to be in the story down the line, once you begin to write the work, it's terribly important to let all of that other stuff remain utterly negotiable. The danger I'm talking about here and why I make this differentiation is that for the artist, the work of art is a manner of exploration. You do not, as the artist, know ahead of time what the ultimate organic object will be. It's impossible. It's too complex. Even a short story is too complex, much less a novel. And so, in not knowing what that ultimately that object is, because for it to be a work of art, that object is going, every tiny detail within it has to organically resonate into everything else. Now, to create such an object, if something that's conceived ahead of time, ahead of coming to it in the order, in the movement forward of that object, because in a novel or a short story, these objects are temporal objects. Their ultimate form is to exist in time. And so, in creating that object, anything that you think you know, or you even sense or intuit or dream that you know about this object that has not yet been arrived at, it may well happen that way. The ending of the story that you dream before you begin writing could turn out to be, in fact, lo and behold, the ending. But if you think about that ending, if you put that out there as a thing that you know will have its place in that way in the work, that's what I'm saying is the dangerous thing. And in fact, that destroys the object, because then you begin to point all of these decisions toward getting there, when in fact, there are all kinds of things that you will never know, you can never anticipate, things that are crucial to the work that are impossible to know ahead, no matter how much you've pre-dreamed, which, as I say, I actually encourage. But you, no matter how much you do that, there are incredibly crucial things within the object that will happen that you absolutely cannot anticipate. And when those things happen, you must, for the organic wholeness of that object ever to come together, you must be free to move wherever that takes you. And even if it means letting go of that thing that you had dreamed before that you think you're getting to. If you don't do that, then the object will fall apart as an art object. And the non-artist, and let's just call them that without, you understand, any sense of stigma. I'm not trying to create some kind of snobbish hierarchy here that, oh, the artists are so much better, and then these other writers, they got this other thing going and it's not worthwhile. Wonderfully worthwhile. The Harry Potter books are wonderful books of their own type and with their own methods and goals. Jean-Paul Sartre's novels are wonderfully provocative and intellectually stimulating. Stephen King is fun to read. I mean, they have wonderful ways of purposes for being. By the way, Glenn, come on in so you can see it. This is Glenn Retief, one of our graduate students, and thanks so much, my friend. We'll see you.
Good.
Thank you. Good night. So here are the questions, and I'm still going to go back and make this one last point for Hugh. So that those folks then, they know that ending so firmly that they will make everything move toward that inevitably. They do not give themselves that. They do not go into the place in them that will surprise them in a substantial way, because that ending is still going to be achieved no matter what. And those objects then have a different life, a different reality, a different kind of place in our culture and in the way in which the reader encounters it. And so that's why I think that, and for the artist to engage the legitimate methodology of the non-artist is a dangerous thing, and it makes the art object much more difficult to achieve, if not impossible. And that's why it's important to distinguish, and the distinction is in what I just said. Okay. Seraphine, and I'm sorry I'm going to mispronounce your last name, Begadu, but Seraphine from London, England, is watching us in London, asks, when does an idea run away from being a short story and grow into a novel? Well, first of all, I'm going to, Seraphine, gently substitute something other than idea. The word idea is one that I like to move my students away from using, because it clearly implies the willful analytical thing that I've just been talking about. But when the concept or the inspiration for a work becomes a novel instead of a short story, I think the distinction can be understood in this way. And the way I'm going to put it now is a kind of metaphor, because I do not, as you might imagine from what I've said before in other way, on other subjects, I do not recommend having too fully formed image of your audience when you write. So the way I'm going to speak now is sort of metaphorical, but I see the distinction between when an inspiration is going to be a short story or a novel. I see it this way. For the short story writer, you're saying to your reader, in essence, sit down, and I don't have much time, but I want you to sit here and listen, and I want to tell you about this moment and the things that lead up to this moment in the life of a character who's kicking around in my imagination, the character at the center of the story I'm about to tell. There are these things that are going to lead up to a moment when, for that character, something will change or happen or move or come to a resolution or be understood suddenly in a new way. And so for the short story writer, though there will be a linking, certainly, of some number of incidents, some events, ultimately the focus for the short story inspiration is on the moment. Things will turn on a moment. When it grows, when the inspiration grows into or is, to start with, a novel, the relationship is different. You find yourself thinking, you know, in essence saying to your reader, all right, this is going to take some time. Let's go off. Let's take a long walk, start this. And let me tell you on this walk, about all of these incidents, all these events, all these moments, a lot of moments, that ultimately in the life of this character that I think fit together in a cause and effect way to lead to some ultimate understanding here. And for the novel writer, though there are many, may well be moments, revealing moments within the work, ultimately the novelist's focus, instead of being on the moment, is on that the linking of things, that linking of cause and effect. It doesn't have to be a linear thing all the time. There can be, you know, it could be a very complex kind of chain, but ultimately it winds around in a certain direction. But the short story inspiration is going to feel like, inevitably, it really hinges on a moment, or comes to a moment. And the novel inspiration, you're really much more focused on the way things connect together. And that's, you know, in over an extended period. Okay. We'll do that one tomorrow night. That's a long one. How do you, or does one, objectively critique their own work from an artistic and creative point of view? And this question is from Marion DePaula in San Pedro, California. Well, Marion, this is where the novelist's or the fiction writer's bad memory serves in still another way. I quoted or paraphrased Graham Greene some nights ago in saying that all good novelists have bad memories. That what you forget comes out as journalism, and what you remember goes into the compost of the imagination. Well, that's a real important function for a fiction writer's bad memory. That is, that you don't get caught in your literal memory, because you don't remember very much. And I don't remember very much, certainly. I don't remember what I've said from one webcast to the next. That's one reason why I might be repeating myself, but it's worth repeating. But the other usefulness of the bad memory is that you forget your sentences. And the how to do it of this is that you learn how long it takes you to forget what you've written. Because the reviewing, the redreaming of the work for the purpose of revising and, you know, critiquing toward making it better, that process involves your returning to your own work without being able to fill in the blanks that you've inadvertently left there. The problem is that we get so close when we're inside the perceptions of the characters and so forth. One of the problems of language is that what we put on the page, we are so close to that inner life of that character that we may not put everything on the page that needs to be there for an outsider to know the things that we are already knowing from the inside. And the problem then of objectively reading your work in order to revise it is that when we go back to read it and it has not cooled off, we have not forgotten it, we have not forgotten what the inner state was that we were in when we wrote it, we may be blind to the things that are left out or the things that are
stated in a way that could be misunderstood, because we are filling in those words with the unspoken stuff that should be there, but and we don't realize it's not there. So the crucial thing is learn how long it takes you to forget. And if you have to put your, you know, you finish your draft and you try to do the best you can to redream it and rewrite it, but then you have to put it away for as long as it takes for you to forget the inner life that you were in when you wrote it, so that you can go back and read it with that cool eye as if you were encountering it for the first time. And the worse your memory, the better in that regard. Sometimes when my memory is really bad, I'm very grateful for it, and I forget a sentence almost as soon as I write it. I will write sentences and then read them over 3 minutes later, and it's like, where did that come from? Okay. David O'Brien from Hatfield, Pennsylvania says, I know you've touched on some details of organizing a story in the past, but how do you decide whether a story novel is best told in chronological order, or the more complex method of starting at the end, then flashing back to the beginning, or the endless possible variations of organizing a story? What are the advantages and disadvantages? And have you ever changed the organization after starting a story in, say, the chronological order, and if so, why? Okay. The fundamental answer to this question of what is best, any of these questions of technique and craft and approach about what is best to use in what situations, it's hard for me to answer in a general way, because the general truth here is, and I'm going to say this again, is that the work of art is organic. And so that each vision, each yearning character coming from your dream space, moving through the world of your that you create in the story or the novel, that has to be the uniquely governing principle for everything else in the story. So whether the story is best told beginning to end, or end to beginning, or some other combination, the fundamental sensual pattern, the pattern of sensual experience represented and embedded in that choice, and the emotional, psychological, spiritual, whatever levels of implication there are from that choice, those have to be organically whole and appropriate to everything else in the story, which then is bending itself around the yearning of the central character. So I can't really generalize for you when it's best to use a straight chronology or when it's best to break that up. I mean, I have done both in drastic ways. My early novels were mostly chronological. The Alleys of Eden, my first novel, had major sections of reminiscence and free-floating back and forth. But Countrymen of Bones, certainly Sundogs, Wabash, those novels were pretty straightforward in time. Books like They Whisper are incredibly complex in relationship to time. And in each case, it had to do with what the characters' yearnings were, the world in which those characters were working those yearnings out, and those things ultimately dictated what was best. There is no generalized answer about how to take it. It's not a template to go and apply to a particular story. Important question, David, and I wish I could give you an easy answer that you could more readily than apply, but I'm afraid that it has to do with matters that are that are so internal to your unique work that I can't generalize beyond that. Glenn Retief, who was just here, has a question that I've been putting off because I've been wanting, you know, my own students have always have access to me. This is a good one, a fairly short answer one. And Glenn's, by the way, from Cape Town, South Africa. Some writers, like Annie Lamott, say that they like to write messy first drafts quickly and then tinker with them later. Obviously, your method is quite different from this. What do you think of the differences in process between writers? Well, Glenn is still working on his internet connection, and so when he watches this whole sequence, he'll know I've... But these things are worth repeating. I would refer all of you back to... because this attends to the draft writing and pre-dreamer question. And the thing I want to address from Glenn's question here, and that's the new part of the question, is, you know, how do you decide for yourself which you want to do? Ultimately, folks, your own artistic sensibility is as unique to you as the stories that you will write. And indeed, sometimes the individual stories will and novels will push you toward one technique or the other, one way of approaching or another. The great, messy, sprawling first draft writer does that because she understands that her own process is that if you don't know which you are, I would suggest you try the method I taught you a few nights ago. But when it seems that that method is drawing you up into your head, then just abandon it. Get away from it as fast as you can, because that's why draft writers do what they do, in order to stay out of their analytical, rational, intellectual selves. They try to avoid the willing of their work into being. They try to avoid writing from their minds and the fact is that works of art are so incredibly complex and so ambitious and so ardently in pursuit of issues that are so universal that they cannot be gotten at. They cannot be adequately expressed in the reductive terms of abstraction. These writers, you know, that impulse is so strong that when the writer realizes that the only way she can stay in her dream space is by not making any choices at all in the moment-to-moment writing except the easy choices that are there at hand and then pushing on, because starting to do any kind of reworking or any kind of pre-planning will just destroy the process, then you know you've got to be a draft writer. Try the other method I taught you the other night if you want to see if you can go the other way. But the dream space is all. Well, thanks for joining me. Please come back tomorrow night for another episode of Inside Creative Writing, and we will pursue this story further. Good night.